Today, I'm going to show you how to make this super realistic cemetery sign out of foam.
So here is a mock-up of the cemetery sign. I created it in Canva. Then I imported it into the Cricut app and used a deep cut blade to cut the design into 2 millimeter thick craft foam. Next, I used Loctite spray adhesive to glue the foam letters to my sign. It helps if you lay the letters out on the sign first before you start gluing so that you know exactly where to stick them. Next, I knew I wanted some sort of like Victorian Main Street USA trim work on this sign, so I pulled out my projector, found an image that I liked, and I just traced it onto the foam. This is an easy hack to get good, clean designs on foam, and it's much quicker and easier than cutting out a stencil. Anytime you're doing a more intricate cut on foam, you want to use a hot wire. This little wire tool heats up to 700 degrees Fahrenheit and it slices through foam like it's melted butter. This is the easiest way to get clean cuts in your foam projects. And I'll link this tool below if you want to try this yourself. Next, we started painting. I always start my paint projects with a coat of flat black cheap house paint. It works perfectly, and you need the black in all the nooks and crannies for shading later. You want to come back after the black coat is done and very lightly add either a light gray or a light beige color to the prop. To get this lightly misted effect, I just turn down the pressure on my paint sprayer, hold the nozzle further away, and I just keep layering the lighter color until it has the effect I want. The last coat of paint I do is always a watered down brown. You can see that I just drizzle it along the top of the prop, and then I come back and spray it down with a generous amount of water and just kind of work the brown in with a paintbrush, just dragging it down until it has the weathered effect that I'm going for. And you can just pat it down with a paper towel if you make any mistakes. But the whole goal is to make the sign look like it's been sitting in the rain for the last 200 years. Now I need a way to mount the sign in the yard. So I had extra foam blocks and I decided to make smaller versions of the driveway pillars that I made earlier this season. So I'm just using a jigsaw to cut out the top and bottom trim pieces for both of the pillars. Since the pillars are really chunky, I am using chunkier 2-inch thick EPS foam. I'm also measuring out a piece of 1x3 wood. I am going to glue this to the back of each of the columns, and this is what I use to zip tie the columns to the fence posts in the yard.
So you can get these little metal, I don't even know what these are called. I ripped the tag off. But they're for crafting. I got these at Michael's. You're going to cut them down to where they're about yay long. And you're just gonna do that. And so this is what they all look like when you're done cutting.
So I am going to stick 4 of these pins into this bottom trim piece. I'm going to add a healthy layer of liquid nails. I'm going to line up the foam block and then I am just going to press it down. So you're going to repeat that process again, 4 pins, a healthy coating of liquid nails, and then add the second styrofoam block, and then repeat it one more time for the top trim piece. The metal pins add a lot of stability, and that liquid nails is not going to come unglued without quite a bit of force. When you're done with your assembly, just throw a heavy paint can on top and let them cure overnight. So the next day I came back downstairs and started working on engraving. The whole idea is to make the foam look like it's really stone. So I start with beveling all of the sharp edges on the trim pieces. And you can see I am just rocking that hot wire back and forth so that it makes, you know, just a random pattern. You want to make sure that you hit every edge, top, bottom, corners, because the straight lines are a dead giveaway.
So the top is done. You're going to want to repeat that process on the edges. And you want to kind of carve out any imperfect areas like this. It's just a dent in the foam from where the trailers were sitting on.
And you can see where I am just going in and carving out all the little places where it's sticking up, the damaged spots, and all the corners. Next, I go in with a heat gun. I set it on the hottest setting and I just go over the entire prop. This is going to soften up all of the imperfections and smooth them out. It's going to create a really nice stone-like texture. It's actually going to help harden up the foam so it is damaged less easily. And you can even use your hot gun tool to create really cool pitting and indentations so that it looks more like an actual chunk of stone. So the last hot tool we're going to use on this prop is a soldering pin. This pin heats up to 900 degrees Fahrenheit. This pin is only $3.99 to buy, and it is the perfect temperature and size to make very spooky cracks in all of your props. You can also use it to engrave letters and trim and whatever else you need. Now that the columns are carved out, it is time to paint again. And I just repeat the same painting process that I did on the sign itself. I start with a coat of flat black paint. You want to turn the pressure all the way up on your paint gun so that it is a very thick coat, and you want to make sure you get it in all of the cracks and crevices that you just carved. Black is going to be the foundation for all of your shading and all of your dimension, so it's very important that you start with a coat of black and don't try to add it in after the fact. I had to let it dry, so I went to bed, and the next day me and Tyler went out to run some errands, and he spotted an entire trailer filled with more foam blocks, free for the taking, so we pulled over and stuffed as many as we could fit in the back of the Suburban. Isn't he such a good husband? He supports all of my crazy weird hobbies. Then he dragged me to Academy, where I immediately went to find all of the hunting animal decoys. Look at these crows, only $8. How perfect are those for Halloween props? Then I dragged him to the Peddler's Mall and tried to convince him to buy me this giant ostrich statue. He wouldn't, but he did get me these awesome turkey vultures. And since the Suburban was stuffed with foam, they had to ride up in the front with us. So when we got back home, I pulled out my paint sprayer, loaded it with some light gray paint, and I started painting on the second coat. Then I got the light beige out and added a third coat because I needed them to be lighter to match the sign. I thought it looked pretty good at this point. Had to test out the turkey vultures. I thought those looked pretty good too. And if you're wondering why I have all this face paint on, it's because I was testing my Madame Leota costume. Okay, back to painting. It's time for the watered down brown to make it look old and weathered. I just spritzed the column with some water, rubbed the watered down brown paint over it with a paintbrush, let it sit for a few minutes, and then I walked around and sprayed them one more time. Spraying water really just helps kind of diffuse the paint so that you have like a lot of really subtle dimension. I used a lot of water, so I had some pooling. I just dabbed it up with a paper towel. While I had the watered down brown paint out, I went ahead and added some to these turkey vultures so they would look a little bit older and less
shiny and brand new. You can see the difference between the one I painted and the brand new one. Then it was time to attach the sign to the columns, so I got out my snippers and these metal pins, cut them down to size, and I used 4 metal pins in each side of the sign. I just stuck them right in. Not only do these pins add a lot of stability to your props, but they are also really convenient when you are doing your install because they can kind of hold the sign in place while you're leveling it and measuring it out to make sure that it's in there evenly. So once it's level, you just add some liquid nails and then very carefully start working those pins into the columns and getting that sign nice and smushed in there. Now, since the columns weigh nothing, I needed to add some tension so that this glue will adhere really tightly. So I just grabbed some paracord and tightened it up, and this sort of pulled the columns together against the sign to add just a little bit of pressure. And of course, don't forget cheesy pictures with your prop after your build, otherwise it doesn't count. Installing the turkey vultures on the sign prior to installation turned out to be a big mistake because the sign fell over and the turkey vultures completely disintegrated, and I had to use liquid nails and new screws to get them reattached, and one of them just ended up being unsalvageable. So here's a close-up shot of me mounting the prop in the yard using a $4 fence post and some zip ties. This is my favorite way to mount my props. It's inconspicuous and extremely secure. That is not coming out of the ground now that it is in there. I hope you enjoyed this build as much as I did. I think it turned out fantastic, and it looks even better at night, all lit up in the yard. Thank you so much for watching, and be sure to like, comment, and subscribe for more Halloween prop making content from Memento Mori Curiosities and Props.